Okay. All right. I'd like to thank you for being with us this afternoon and contributing to the Space Walk of Fame's Oral History Program. And I'd like to begin by asking you to state your name and when you became affiliated with the space program.
My name is Samuel T. Beddingfield, better known as Sam. And I started in the space program in the latter part of 1985. I was got out of the Air Force. I had been testing airplanes for the Air Force at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, and I got out of that, came back to Eastern North Carolina, where my wife's father had a 700-acre farm, and I decided I would go be a farmer, and it took me about 3 days to realize I really didn't care anything about farming. But NASA, as a government agency, was less than a year old, so I drove 2 miles up to Langley Field, Virginia, where NASA headquarters were, and I decided at that point I would like to go to working on rockets, or no, on airplanes. So I went and talked to the airplane people, and unfortunately they didn't have any slots. I'm an aeronautical engineer, that's my college degree, and so I thought what I would do is go back and work on that farm until they could get a slot up there and I could go be an aeronautical engineer again. But the guy that was running the place said, no, you don't want to do that. Says, what you need to do is go over there to the other side of the base and talk to the rocket people. Said, they need people real bad. And I thought, well, okay, I don't know anything about rockets. He says, they don't either. Says, go over there. So drove my car and he had to drive all the way around the runway and get to the other side and drove up to this little building. And I went in there and the first person I ran into was Gus Grissom, who was one of the original astronauts. But that was perfect for me because Gus and I had been in the Air Force together before he became an astronaut, and we tested airplanes together at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Dayton, Ohio. So Gus says, oh, you're here. I said, well, yeah, I was going to get me a job. He says, you don't have a uniform on. I said, no, I got out of the Air Force. He says, that's perfect. You can come to work here. I said, Gus, you know I don't know anything about rockets. He says, nobody does. Come on in. So he says, now, you don't have a uniform on. I said, no, I got out of the Air Force. He says, that's perfect. I said, what do you mean? He said, you see something here that you don't like and you want to quit? You get up and walk out and there's nothing they can do about it. It's not like being in the Air Force. So I said, okay. So I was at Langley Field, Virginia, 2 weeks, and they told me they needed me to go on temporary trip. And so they sent me down here to Cape Canaveral to help get Project Mercury started down here. And that was very early October 1959. And I've been here ever since. 42 years later, I'm telling everybody what I did in the early days of Project Mercury. And I got down here and found out we had one half of one hangar was the entire NASA facility at what's now Cape Canaveral. At Hangar S, we had half of it. But they told us very quickly that we were going to take over that whole hangar. So they told me, you're going to be the mechanical engineer. I said, why is that? They said, well, electrical and everything else, we already know what that covers. We just don't really know what mechanical covers, so you're going to have everything else. So that's what I started working on. And the first thing they told me to do was to make sure that the south part of Hangar S, the second floor over there, was set up ready for us to move astronauts in. So I went over there to see about it. And there was offices over there, and I went over and told one guy who was occupying the office, a fellow named Bob Gray, who later on ended up being my boss, I told him, I said, you're going to have to move. We're going to use your office for something else. He says, I'm not going to move out. So I said, okay, be real careful then, because we're going to tear the walls down. And that's what we did. We tore it all down and built up the second floor, the south side of Hangar S, and that's what became the crew quarters for the 7 astronauts that we had.
And these crew quarters, are they designed for short-term, long-term?
Primarily, they were short-term, but not just a few hours. They had a place to sleep and everything else, mm-hmm. but it was also a little office space in there for them, too. We only had 7 astronauts, so you didn't have to worry too much. And we had the whole second floor, the south side of the hangar, set up for it.
And were these quarters like dormitory style, or did they all have their own, each have their own little cubicle or room, so to speak?
They had their own little room, but I think they had one central bathroom, that kind of stuff. So it was not really just a closet type thing. It was a little bit better than that. It was a bedroom, and but you didn't really have a very fancy place. The whole Project Mercury was not very fancy. If you look at what we were doing with Project Mercury, and you compare it to what we're doing today, we probably wouldn't survive but about 1 or 2 days. But we had a good time with Mercury, and so we decided, all right, now what the flying is going to be. We were shooting rockets that were unmanned to get so we could understand what was going on. The first ones we used were Redstone rockets. And the Redstone rocket is really, well, when you think about it today, it's kind of small. But in those days, it was not a small rocket. It just didn't go very fast or very far. And with a weight of a Mercury spacecraft on it, which was about 2,000 pounds, you could fly that thing about 100 miles high and around 300 miles downrange. And the speed it got to was about 5,000 miles an hour, and that was it. Now, to go to Earth orbit, you have to go at least 17,300 miles an hour. So the Redstone was not good enough for that, but it was good enough to test the Mercury spacecraft in space and make sure the crew could survive all right. So we set it up, and we got a Redstone rocket, and we took a production Mercury spacecraft, but no people in it. We were going to fly them with tests first. And the first one we took down to the pad, we put it on there, and all of us were assigned various things. Now, my job, since I was the mechanical engineer, I was not to be in the blockhouse, because when we got into the blockhouse, they locked the doors, because the blockhouse was not very far away from the pad. And they sent me to the outside to be as close to the pad as they felt like there was some safe place for me and about 3 other people to be. And we got there so we could watch the liftoff of this rocket. And they counted it all down, and they zeroed, and they fired the engine. And the Redstone rocket lifted off about 1 inch. And the rocket engine shut down. And the whole thing sat back down. And but when we had told the spacecraft what to do, we said, you start your stuff after the Redstone rocket shuts its engines down. So it did exactly what it was supposed to do. The first thing it did was jettison the escape rocket. It fired off, and then the parachutes came out, drag chute, regular main parachute. All of the thrusters fired in the complete order they were supposed to, and everything worked in the spacecraft like it was supposed to, except it was still sitting on the pad, so you didn't need the parachutes deployed. And we sat there, not knowing whether the thing, it was not locked down at all, so if the wind came up and got a parachute, it could have turned the whole thing over. But we were very fortunate, and he sat there for 24 hours we got to it to take the parachute that was strapped to the spacecraft off so it wouldn't turn the thing over. The rocket was still loaded with its propellant and everything. So we felt like we were very lucky there. And that was our first Project Mercury launch. but after that, we got much better. We flew 2 or 3 unmanned ones, and then finally got to Alan Shepard and said, okay, Al, you're going to be the first American to go into space. And we launched him on Mercury Redstone 3.
Now, did you know prior to the launch that it was going to be Alan Shepard? Were you privy to that information? Because I know it was very secret as to exactly who was in the silver suit. Were you privy to the knowledge?
Yes, we knew, a few days before that, what the launch would be. It would be Shepherd, Grissom, and Glenn. Mm-hmm. We knew what the rates were going to be. Mm-hmm. We weren't sure of the Glenn launch because we wanted to fly the Redstone. See, Shepherd flew the first Redstone and Grissom flew the second Redstone, and we didn't know whether we would need to fly another Redstone or not, but mm-hmm. we decided pretty quickly after Grissom's flight that no, we just need to go ahead and start flying the Atlas rocket, which could get it up to the 17,300 miles an hour.
What were the feelings for the people who, the pad workers and the people who were at the launch during Shepard's, as you're counting
everybody
down?
Everybody was very, very, very interested in what's going on. What have I done that may be wrong? We mm-hmm. certainly don't want to have any accident caused by something that I did wrong or that I know somebody else did wrong. Mm-hmm. And so it was a lot of people who were really thinking hard. And when it lifted off, you could see a lot of people get relaxed. Now, I was not one of the relaxed people when it lifted off, because one of the things I was responsible for was the parachutes to get the crew back. So I couldn't relax until after the parachutes came out and it landed in the ocean mm-hmm. and we got the crew out. So even though the flight only lasted 15 minutes, it made a long 15 minutes for me.
Let me ask that, since this is America's first man in space, mm-hmm. and it's not an orbital flight, it's suborbital, the Soviets have already launched Yuri Gagarin in April, and that is an entire orbit.
Mm-hmm.
What were the feelings after Gagarin's launch?
Well, right down here, we were so busy trying to make ours work. We didn't even have time to do much studying on what the Russians did. Mm-hmm. And since then, we've looked up what they did. And if you look how that flight flew, when it came down, the parachute opened up for a while, but then they had an ejection seat that ejected the astronaut or mm-hmm. cosmonaut out of the thing, and he came down just by a manned parachute. It wasn't anything at all like what we were doing. Mm-hmm. The thing was entirely different as to what we did and what they did. So we felt like we were trying to catch up, but we were trying to catch up a proper way. And of course, things went on when we flew Grissom down, with the second flight. When Gus's spacecraft landed, for some strange reason, the hatch blew, and that was the first one with an explosive hatch on it. And the hatch blew, and Gus fortunately got out because the spacecraft sunk and went 16,000 feet deep in the ocean out there. And we did get that back. Mm-hmm. And that was another thing that I was concerned about, because some of the stuff that I had put on a Mercury spacecraft, we had an explosive device that came out with the parachute, and when the parachutes opened up, it stretched the line enough to flip this 3/4 of a pound of explosive into the ocean. And that was one way you could identify where it was. We had places around the Earth where you could find out what the site was. And then we had that one would explode at about 3,500 feet deep in the ocean. And then we had another one set to go off at 4,500 feet that was bolted to the spacecraft. And I was just about convinced that one had went off, and if we went down there to try to pick that spacecraft up, we weren't going to find anything. You get 3/4 of a pound of HBX, and that's a pretty good size explosive.
So the purpose of these explosives
was just to help locate the thing.
So in the event, so this was a precautionary mm-hmm. measure that
that's
in the
right.
event a craft did sink.
Yeah, we would know where. And also, the first one was, okay, where did it come down? Mm-hmm. Because that explosive device came out when the parachute came out, so you would know about where it would be.
And you could detect this through sonar?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And the second one was, if it went deep enough for the second one to go off, then you really had a mess because you blew the whole spacecraft, and it was too deep to get anything out. The parachutes didn't work. So, and that was an interesting thing in Gus's flight, in that we never did find out anything about that second device. When we finally fished it up out of the ocean, it was, the spacecraft was 16,000 feet deep. We pulled it up, and the device that was supposed to go off was still in it, but it had not exploded. So I felt pretty good we got the spacecraft back, because I was almost convinced we weren't going to get it back.
Since you knew Grissom prior to Mercury, after his flight, did he ever talk to you about?
Yes, I talked to him quite a bit after the flight, because a lot of people thought that he had fired the explosive that blew the hatch off. And I knew that if he had done that, he would tell me. We had flown airplanes, we had tested airplanes enough together in the Air Force, that when anything went wrong, we knew we had to tell each other about it. And I talked, they put me on a team to go interview Gus as to what happened. And he told me he did not fire that hatch, which was an interesting thing, because all the other Mercury flights had an explosive hatch on them, same type of thing. And every one of the crew members on that had a place right here on the back of his hand. When they fired the hatch, it felt the, you could
like
tell.
A bruise.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Gus did not have one in his hand. Mm-hmm. And when we got the spacecraft back, we found out that the hatch could have done something that we don't even understand, but Gus did not fire it. So we felt fairly confident in that. Mm-hmm. And I was glad we got him back. And the trouble is, a lot of people don't realize what a significant astronaut he really was. He flew, later on, he flew the first Gemini spacecraft, mm-hmm. and was set up to fly the first Apollo spacecraft when he was killed. He was a very, very good pilot. I flew a lot with him back when we were in the Air Force together.
Did you notice that after the event, was he sensitive at all to?
Yes. Well, before that, when they had Alan Shepard, they had up there, and they had interviews with the president and everything else, mm-hmm. and they didn't do much of that for him. And then when John Glenn flew, they had interviews with the president, so he felt like he got kind of left out. Mm-hmm. And I totally agree with him.
Just to digress just a little bit while we're on the subject, I'm curious about his wife. Did you have much, since you knew her husband quite well, since you knew Gus quite well,
yes.
Did you see Betty often?
Not too often, no. Mm-hmm. Most of the time, the only wife of the astronauts that came down here a lot was John Glenn's wife. Mm-hmm. Most of the other guys, they would fly down, and they usually would fly a military airplane down here, and so the wives weren't with them. Mm-hmm. And I had met her two or three times, and of course since the accident, I met her very carefully, but mm-hmm. it was just not that much. You knew the astronauts as what they were, as an astronaut, and that mm-hmm. was it.
Not to put you on the spot at all, and mm-hmm. if you don't want to answer this, I mean, but feel free not to. But as far as and Carpenter is concerned,
mm-hmm.
Would you consider Carpenter to be an exceptional pilot astronaut, or of the same caliber as the others?
I wouldn't consider him as the same caliber as the others. I don't think he could do near as well as the other guys did. I don't think he did. When he flew his mission, he was flying right after John Glenn flew. John flew three revs around the Earth, and we were going to fly three revs with him. He burned almost all the fuel up in about two-thirds of the first orbit. And he was not following what we had told him to do, what we needed to do in the flight or anything. And fortunately, he didn't get hurt or anything, and we saved the spacecraft. But I don't think he followed the rules like we thought people should follow the rules.
Mm-hmm.
And he never flew another spacecraft.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that is in part why he left? NASA to go to C-Lab? That
well, I think part of it was, and another thing that to go to C-Lab was a very interesting thing. That was a world we sure didn't know anything about, and he was going to learn about it. Mm-hmm. I couldn't take totally everything away from him. He was obviously a pretty good person to be selected as an astronaut. Mm-hmm. When they first started selecting astronauts, they started off with 3,000 names, mm-hmm. and they got down to 7. They were trying to get to 6, and they couldn't find any way to get down to just 6, so they had to stay with 7. Mm-hmm. Primarily, they had 3 Air Force people, 3 Navy people, and 1 Marine.
Mm-hmm. let's talk about the Marine now, if you don't mind.
All right.
So we've done the suborbital flights.
Yeah.
Okay. And now we're getting ready to have our first orbital mm-hmm. American flight.
Right.
Okay. What is the atmosphere, both at the Cape for the workers, and then after we've addressed that, I was wondering if you could maybe discuss the overall atmosphere here in the community. How did people react to John Glenn's flight, the parades, and things of this nature?
Okay. Well, when we launched the first orbital flight with people in it, John flew the first one. And that thing, the day it lifted off, almost all of the schools and everything else went totally so they could see it fly. And it flew only 3 orbits, so that's only pretty close to 5 hours, about an hour and a half per orbit. So it just blew the whole day that everybody was interested in what we were doing with an American flying orbit around the Earth. And when John got back, of course, one of the first things they did was give him a medal in Washington. They got all of Congress together to hear what he had to say about flying. And then it wasn't too long before he came down here and you could get everybody that was involved in the flight to hear what John had to say about it. We had the spacecraft back and we had taken it apart and looked at it. But the people at the Smithsonian said, yes, that's coming to us. So we didn't get a chance to stay with it very long. We had to get it ready to be shipped to the Smithsonian in Washington. Mm-hmm. And if you want to go see it, that's where it is now, hanging from the ceiling.
Did it, I remember seeing some photos from the 1962 Seattle World's Fair. Mm-hmm. Did Glenn's capsule go to the Seattle World's Fair, because NASA had a large pavilion there?
I don't think it did. I think it was still in Washington at the Smithsonian. Okay. But it may have been some of the other. Now you realize we flew several unmanned Mercury flights, even with Redstones and with Atlases. And it could have been, I don't remember what went up there then, it could have been one of the other spacecraft.
Okay. Now, with Glenn's flight, with the numerous delays and stuff, could you discuss a little bit about the feelings of the workers with all the delays?
Yeah, you take me, I worked very hard at it, and I was almost to the point where I didn't know whether we'd ever get it off or not. You know, one of the things that we really wanted to do was launch it in December of 1961. And we got to looking around and the weather was getting a little bit marginal, and I think the president decided that right before Christmas is not the time to have some kind of thing that may be a risk. So we slipped it and said, okay, we'll go right past Christmas. And we went past Christmas. But then we started and we'd find something wrong and we'd work on it and fix that, and then we'd find something else wrong and fix that, and it was late February before we ever got it to go. So it was very frustrating to try to say when we were going to launch that thing, and we knew it was our first manned orbital flight, and we figured that's very critical because the Russians had already flown 2 or 3 times in orbit with mm-hmm. people. And we wanted to show the world we could do it.
How about with the press? There's a lot of press here covering
yes.
Glenn's flights. Did anybody ever approach you at the time to get you to try to talk about what was going on out there. Did the press hound you, like at a local restaurant or a bar or anything like
Not
that?
Not too much. You could go down to Cocoa Beach and there'd usually be somebody down there, but it was not pressurizing you or anything like that. It was pretty nice. Most of the guys that are in the, like the local press people, were very good. There was one guy, I think it worked for ABC, he and I didn't get along very well.
Jules Berman?
Yeah, I think that was his name. He was hard to get along with, but the thing I remember best about all of that is Jay Barbree, who's the NBC guy. Jay is still here, and I've worked with him for many, many, many years.
Now, with John Glenn's flight being a success, by chance did you go to any of the parades down in Cocoa Beach?
Yes, I did. Yes.
Did you live in Cocoa Beach at the time?
No. When I got down here, first got down in October of 59, I had been sent down from Langleyfield, Virginia, which I thought was temporary duty. Mm-hmm. So I just had a motel room in Cocoa Beach.
Do you remember by chance the name of the hotel or motel?
No, but I can remember where it was. They've torn it down since then. It was right at the intersection when you take 520 and go out and intersect with A1A. It was on the southwest corner of that intersection.
Would it be
I've got it written down somewhere.
Vanguard?
No, I don't think so.
Astrocraft?
I'd have to look it up. I can't remember it. But that's where it was. Mm-hmm. Right now it's all torn down and there's other things built there. And my wife was staying with her parents in North Carolina because I had not been up at Langleyfield, Virginia long enough to even find a place for us to live up there. I looked around. And I finally called her. It looked like I wasn't going to get back up there real quick. And when I was in the Air Force, I used to go fly somewhere and stay 3 or 4 days and fly back. You know, and she kind of thought that was what the transportation was. And then I called her. I said, it ain't going to be just a few days. She said, okay. Next thing I know, she got on an airliner and flew down here. Mm-hmm. And we were in a motel. I had just gotten out of the Air Force not too long before that, so all of our furniture and everything was in storage places in Dayton, Ohio, because that's where I was at Wright-Patterson. And the traffic was terrible. If you were going to Cape Canaveral, it backed up all the way to where Highway A1A and 520 intersect. That was the traffic that far in. And I figured there must be a better way to get there, so I moved up here to Titusville. And there was two motels here in Titusville, so I found me a motel. And it looked like I was going to be here a while, so I started looking around to see if I could find a house to rent. There was no houses to rent in 1959. So messed around, finally I ended up, and I'm not sure exactly what the plan of everything was, but my birthday is October the 28th, and we were still in a motel then. And sometime between then and November the 14th, I had managed to find a house, and we had moved in it because that's when the first baby was born. It was that close.
What was your wife's impressions of Brevard County when she got here?
She liked it
a whole lot,
yes. Yeah. She was very highly trained and had been quite a bit of traveling and everything too. Mm-hmm. And we had been in the Air Force in Dayton, Ohio for about 2.5 years at that time, so it was kind of fun.
I'm going to pause this here because this tape is getting ready to run out, so I want to flip this over.
Okay.
And when we pick up again, I'm going to start off with we've completed Glenn, so let's move on a little bit to Carpenter, and then Shirah, and then and Mercury with Cooper's flight.
Cooper, yeah, mm-hmm. Okay.
Let me find this back.
Okay. You tell me when.
All right. Okay, we're starting side two now.
Okay.
We've discussed, the suborbital Mercury flights and John Glenn's flight.
Mm-hmm.
A little bit about Carpenter's flight.
Carpenter's flight was scheduled kind of similarly to what we had done with John Glenn's flight, and it was three orbits. And we had told him what we really wanted to do, except as he was flying, he made his own decisions about how he wanted the spacecraft to be handled and everything. So he changed what some of the original plans were, and things happened differently. We had a lot of fuel on board for controlling the spacecraft's attitude, and he burned in 2/3 of the first orbit. He burned quite a bit of that fuel up, so we had to stop that. But we got some very interesting data from his flight, but not anything as remarkable as what we had done with John Glenn's flight. And so we got him back, and we decided the next flight we needed to get better data. So that was going to be Wally Schirra's flight. And we told Wally, okay, you must fly 6 orbits so that we can get more data. And we had better stuff for Wally to do. And as it turned out, he was an excellent astronaut. So we got very, very good data. And when he landed, he came down very, very close to the aircraft carrier he was supposed to be met by. Wasn't any problem at all.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's different from the landing that Carpenter made. When Carpenter, when you flew a shuttle and you really wanted to get from orbit, you were supposed to pitch it down 27 degrees and have it 0 degrees to the right and 0 to the left and flat on the roll. Somehow, he didn't get it exactly like that, and when he fired the retro rockets, it didn't slow it up like we thought it was going to slow it up, and he overshot the landing site by about 300 miles. So it took us a while to get to him and recover him. So we told the next astronauts, you must be very, very careful. So he was very careful, and like I said, he landed it very close to the aircraft carrier that was going to pick him up. And then he made a good 6 rev flight around the Earth 6 times, so you figure about 90 minutes of flight. He was up 9 hours or more. And then the last Mercury flight, Gordon Cooper, we decided, okay, we'd like to get more information, so we flew Gordon for over 24 hours and even let him sleep for a while, which was we weren't sure whether he could or not, but Gus, he was no problem sleeping. He even went to sleep out on the pad. We had to wake him up and tell him we were going to launch him. So he was very relaxed. And we flew that one, and fortunately he knew what he was doing, because some of the batteries and stuff and everything were dying with him, and a lot of the automatic system, when we got ready to retrofire to bring him back, we didn't feel like they were going to work, and he did it manually, and he landed very, very close to the aircraft carrier. So we felt real good with his flight. And that's kind of how we finished up Project Mercury. We didn't get to fly Deke Slayton, who was the 7th astronaut, because they found out that he had a problem with his way his blood was going and everything, so they wouldn't let him fly. They ended up making him as the chief of the astronaut office, because he knew so much about it and what to do. And to make a long story short, the last Apollo-type spacecraft that we flew, he got to fly on it and dock with the Russians.
Before we move on to Gemini, I'd like to ask you a little bit about the relationship at this early phase between the NASA personnel and the contractors.
Okay. If you came to one of the things where NASA and McDonnell people were working together, you would have to get very close to them and read their badges to see if there was any difference. Mm-hmm. It was the very, very nice people. We had a real good time doing it. And the way it got started was interesting, in that NASA was in charge. And they kind of changed that later on, like during the Gemini program, where NASA was supposed to say what we wanted done and have the contractor do it. But what we did in the early Mercury days was NASA was responsible, and you just used the contractor to help out. Mm-hmm. But it didn't really make that much difference. I know some of the stuff that one of the things I had to do was to do the weight and balance on the Mercury spacecraft. And we had to set the spacecraft up and measure everything three-dimensionally. But it was me and McDonald people in there at the same time, and if you had been in the hangar with us, you couldn't tell which was which. They were very, very good.
And did this relationship change with Gemini and Apollo?
It started changing Gemini and Apollo because Congress wanted us to have a contractor chart, and what NASA was supposed to do was to grade the contractor on how good a job he did. And the NASA people were supposed to see what the contractor was doing and did he do the job right. In the early Mercury days, it was NASA's responsibility to do it, and we just used the contractor to help out. It, mm-hmm. it made a difference in how you did it.
Now, as we are venturing toward Gemini, before we get into that, I just want to back a little bit to May of 61, when Kennedy makes his lunar pledge.
Mm-hmm.
At that moment in time, can you recall what your thoughts were at that moment? Would we or would we not be able to obtain this goal by the end of 1960s?
Well, I knew we were going to have a real tough time to do it, because at the time he made that, it was about 3 weeks after we had flown Alan Shepard. And Alan Shepard's flight would go 5,000 miles an hour, and it lasted 15 minutes. To go to the moon, you have to have something that will move 25,000 miles an hour. And we didn't have anything that would do that. And to get all that done in 9 years, we knew it was going to be a job. But fortunately, we did it.
Mm-hmm. Now, with Gemini, we get new astronauts.
Mm-hmm.
We also get a shift in that we have a lot of personnel now being moved to Manned Spacecraft Center with Houston.
Mm-hmm.
Can you discuss any changes here as a result of the move to Houston?
Yes, when we first came down here, the part of NASA that I was with was the part out of, it was not the Langley Research Center. We had even established a little piece at Langley Research Center, which was the manned spaceflight part.
Mm-hmm.
And we got down here, and the people who ended up eventually being in charge of like the Redstone rocket, they were not even NASA people at that time. They were U.S. Army, the ABMA. And then they switched that over to being a part of NASA. But when they switched that over, you had that part of NASA and the part that was the spacecraft. So you had a rocket and a spacecraft, and we didn't do business the same way, and we were two different places. Instead of Houston, was still at Langley. They finally decided that that was where they didn't need those people, and they moved them to Texas. Now, if you wonder why they moved them to Texas, we looked for a long time about moving them to Florida. But if you look at really how you make a decision like that, you see how much support you could get from Congress from Florida, and you got a lot. And you see how much you could get from California, and you got a lot. And then if you went to Texas, you got a whole lot more. So that made a big difference.
Mm-hmm.
Technically, I don't think it made a whole lot of difference in the world whether we went to Texas or stayed in Florida with a lot of the people. But then down here, we had an Alabama crew and a Texas crew. And finally, they decided that was wrong, so then we would make Kennedy Space Center one. And we used the guy who had been running the other place, Kurt Debus, to be the boss. So it took a little bit of doing for all of us who had been the manned spacecraft center people just to go to work for the what was now the Kennedy Space Center.
Did you have much interaction with any of the Germans, von Braun or Debus?
I spent some time with both of them. I had a very good time with von Braun. He came down when we were launching one of the Redstones, and we had some delay, and I was out in the blockhouse and decided I needed to get outside, and I went outside and sat down. Von Braun came out there and sat down beside me, and we must have talked for 45 minutes, I guess. And he was a very, very nice guy. And of course, Debus was the boss down here. And I wasn't sure that I needed to talk to Debus a whole lot, because he was a very technical person. But if you knew what you were doing, you had a good time talking to him. But we had a lot of other people who were very good, like one, G. Merrick Preston, who was the boss of all of us who came down originally from Langley. And Preston, when they made the decision to have who was going to be in charge of Kennedy Space Center, whether it was Debus or Preston, was a big, tough decision. But it ended up where we could finally work together soon.
Now, one last Mercury question, and then we'll move on to Gemini. I'm curious about your average work days.
Oh, the work days, well, every now and then they would get quite long. See, we were working Mercury Redstone and Mercury Atlas at the same time, and I was the mechanical engineer. We didn't have a mechanical engineering department for a long time there. I was the only one, and I would work most of one shift at the Redstone pad and then go to the Atlas pad and work most of that shift. So it was not, you didn't have a 40-hour week that you expected to work. It usually ended up being much longer.
Does create any problems at home?
Not too much for me. Fortunately, my wife was very, very good at it and understood what was going on and everything. So I never had any problem. But there was a lot of people in the space program that got divorces, probably because of that. I was very fortunate.
And what about nightlife? Did the unmarried space workers go out a lot, bars, nightclubs?
Yeah, a lot of stuff at Cocoa Beach.
Do you have any specific recollections of some wild parties or anything down there that you can recall?
Well, it used to be right after launch. When we launched here, we would have a very good party in Cocoa Beach somewhere, or maybe all the way down to Melbourne Beach if you wanted to go that far. And of course, when we launched the Mercury, you know, the flight was over in about, you know, either 5 or 9 hours or so. Mm-hmm. So you could go down there and have a very good party and had a lot of people show up. Mm-hmm. But now once you started flying things like Gemini, which the worst Gemini flight lasted 2 weeks, so you couldn't go do stuff like that.
As we move into Gemini and we have a lull period, between Mercury, you know, the last flight, Cooper's flight, and before Grissom and Young fly in 1965. What were you doing in the latter part of 63 and 64 and in early 65 prepping for the first Gemini flight? What were you specifically doing?
What I was doing was working on Gemini, what we needed to do, the way of getting the necessary buildings and facilities done down here, plus what we were trying to do to settle what we needed to do for Apollo. I was working on both of them. Mm-hmm. And we built, if you go over to the Cape and look, you see Hangar AF over there, which is the first hangar that's south of Hangar S. And that's really what we started the Gemini program in, was Hangar AF. It was built big enough so that we could handle the Gemini spacecraft in there with no problem. And what really amounted in Germany was we finally moved over to what is now Kennedy Space Center on Merritt Island and started working on them over there. But when we first started Germany, we had Hangar AF, which is just immediately south from Hangar S. And it was a good place to work on them.
What precisely did you do there?
We were worried about how could you do the weight and balance? How can you make sure that everything is hooked up properly? We did not have an escape rocket on the Gemini spacecraft like you did on Mercury and on Apollo. So you had to make sure that the seats were put in very, very properly and what the hatches would do. And then the retro rockets and the stuff that controlled it while it was in space, you had to work with that very, very carefully. The ones that said how it was going to fly. In Mercury, we flew and we just stayed in an orbit. You could rotate how the spacecraft was flying, but you could not change the orbit. In Gemini, you had enough propulsion that you could change the height or side to side on it. So we had different rocket engines, and we had to worry about would those work and would they work together. And most of the time they did. On Gemini Flight 8, one of the engines started firing and would not shut down, and they had to cancel that flight, and they landed in the Pacific Ocean rather than the Atlantic Ocean. That was Neil Armstrong's.
That's when it went tumbled end over end over end.
Right, and that was Neil Armstrong's flight. Mm. That was the only one we really had engine troubles with. But, and that was one thing that was a major difference.
Were you present with the Gemini, I believe it was the Shiraz flight, when it didn't light when it was supposed
yes,
to?
Yes, yes. My job there was the same thing that I had done in Mercury, was to be outside the blockhouse in case we had a problem, to go help be part of the rescue crew to rescue the crew. And fortunately, he didn't try to fire the ejection seat or anything, and when about 3 days later we really launched that thing.
Do you have...
And we really needed to launch, because what we had, there was one Gemini 7 was already in orbit, and what we wanted to do was to have Gemini 6 fly out there and get to it. And we didn't have that much time because Gemini 7 couldn't stay up there that long.
Right, Borman and Lovell were up there.
Yeah.
All right. Do you have any, after that event, any interaction with Wally Schirra, or I believe it was Tom, was it not Tom Stafford with him,
mm-hmm.
As to their feelings sitting on top of this when it was supposed to go and it didn't?
Yeah, I've talked to Wally about it, because one of the things that we talked about that I was responsible for was the ejection seats.
Mm-hmm.
And if you fired that ejection seat, you would get about 22 Gs. And I felt like if you ever fired that thing, man, I don't know what's going to happen to you. And I had been talking to Wally about it just a day or two before launch. And he decided unless there was some absolutely mandatory reason, you ought not to fire that thing. So, and he told his, co-pilot there, don't fire it. And they sat there and fortunately, everything worked all right. We could have killed them. It wouldn't have taken much for the whole Titan rocket to blow up, but it didn't. So we felt like they knew what they were talking about. But that ejection seat, I'm just very, very, very pleased we never had to use one of those. If you look during a flight, just to get out of the where the flame from the rocket was, I would think that you probably had somewhere around 20 to 22 seconds that would have been a useful time to use that ejection seat. All the other, now Mercury and Apollo had great big escape rockets which would haul you off, but you didn't have that on Gemini. Fortunately, we never had to use one.
If you were asked, what is the primary success of of Gemini? What is its most important contribution?
To figure out how to maneuver a spacecraft after it was in orbit. On Mercury, you couldn't change the orbit. You either went to orbit or you came back down. On Gemini, we figured out how we could get it to go from, we could set it in orbit, say, at 200 miles. What if you wanted to go 900 miles? How did you do that? And we figured that out with the Gemini. And if you wanted to deviate whether it was going to be flying directly on this path or one to the side of it a little bit, could you do that? And we proved all of that with the Gemini spacecraft. So I thought the maneuvering capability of the spacecraft on orbit was a very good thing that Gemini did.
We're concluding with Gemini in 1966.
Mm-hmm.
When did you move into Apollo? Did you start Apollo yourself personally now, while Gemini was going on?
Yes. I started actually partially in Apollo while Mercury was even going on. And the first Apollo spacecraft that got delivered, you know, they sent one of the escape rockets and stuff in. I was very much involved in Gemini at that time, but also that was one of the parts of the Apollo that I was responsible for. So I never really had a very sharp break between Gemini and Apollo. I was working both of them.
Mm-hmm. Was there as we're developing a massive program, I mean, you know, Mercury's impressive, Gemini is very impressive, but I mean, the scope of Apollo, the amount of workers across the country, I mean, I think there's figures that upwards of 400,000 people contributed to Project Apollo.
Mm-hmm.
And so as we're getting something this massive, do you start to see a change in this type of space worker that's coming here?
Yes. There was more, you had to have more people involved in the thing. And you go back to Mercury, it didn't take many people because you could work on several little issues. But you start getting to the Gemini and then to the Apollo and those spacecraft, which it took many, many more people to work on each one just to make sure that the thing would work.
Mm-hmm.
When you're going 25,000 miles an hour, you know, that's 7 miles a second, so you don't have much time for something to go wrong. So you have to make sure that it's working like it's supposed to.
And with Apollo, are you still working fairly regular hours? I mean, you're not doing long shifts. Are you still working?
It depended. Now, where I had moved to the program office rather than being in the mechanical engineering division. And to deal with the people I need to deal with, Houston went, their daily morning shift started at 8:30 Houston time, which is 9:30 Kennedy time. And so they would go until 5 o'clock, 8:30 to 5, which is 6 o'clock here. And then anytime we had to deal with the people in Downey, California, you add 3 more hours to that. So a lot of times during my time in the Apollo days was not just an 8-hour day. You had a lot of stuff to do and you did it.
Your memories of the first Apollo, what would have been Apollo 204, which would have been the first Apollo launch, mm-hmm. with Grissom. Since you knew him personally, did he share any apprehension about the Apollo spacecraft?
Yes, I had talked to him about it. In fact, the day that accident happened was my last day in mechanical engineering. It was on a Friday. And Monday, I was supposed to move to the Apollo project office. But it was felt like there was something I really needed to have Gus do. So I came 7:30 in the morning on Friday so that I could make sure that I could communicate with Gus. And we talked for a while and then he decided, okay, he wanted to go through the test that he was in. But as soon as that test was over, he was going to be inside the Apollo spacecraft, all hooked up and everything, and I could come spend about 10 minutes with him to discuss the type of problem we were interested in. So it started, it went on and on and on, and they were having so many problems, it was delaying it, delaying it, and delaying it. So finally, late afternoon, I decided, okay, I went down to Cocoa Beach to eat supper, and when I came back, I was just coming in the gate when the thing exploded. So, and then, I don't, that was at 6:31 p.m., I can remember that exactly. And I found out, you know, that it had killed the crew. And I never, that was on Friday. And my next trip home was Tuesday at 9 p.m. I stayed busy just trying to see if I could figure out what went on. Your red light is flashing.
That means that we've got 5 minutes left to take time.
All right.
Then we'll break and I'll give you a couple of minutes and we'll finish up Apollo on another tape.
Okay, yeah. Whatever you want to do. But that was what we were doing, and they were really wanted to set something up so we could investigate that accident. And one of the things they asked me to do was to be the number two guy for taking the spacecraft apart. And they selected one of the Houston people to be chairman of that. And he, at one time, we had worked together very closely. He stayed here 2 weeks and decided he needed to go back to Houston. So I was in charge of taking the spacecraft apart after the accident. And it took me 6 months to get all that done.
Did you work closely with Borman then?
Yeah. What I did, we took the spacecraft apart. We picked it up off the thing and took it over to a building over what's now Kennedy Space Center. And we built a building inside of that. I went up to Langley Field, Virginia, and went over to where the Air Force had a place over there, the Navy did. And we got a piece of a hangar and brought it down here, and that's where the spacecraft was put in. And we took the spacecraft apart piece by piece by piece and stored it in that building. That building was probably, I don't know, 40 feet long or so. And put it in there and took it apart piece by piece, and every piece was stored on shelves around that building. And then when we got through, I sealed the building up, put a like about a 3-foot by 3-foot door to get in it, filled the entire building up with nitrogen, and we put it on a ship and took it to Langley Field, Virginia, because we were going to be responsible. I found out later on, after we started that we were going to be responsible for 10 years to answer anybody's questions. So I talked to the boss, and he says, I want you to have it so that they can get in if they want to, but they got to have a good reason. So I set it up and filled that building up with nitrogen. So you have to have an oxygen mask to go in for that. So the rule I wrote was you had to come to Kennedy Space Center and get trained on how to use the oxygen mask. Go back up to Langley Field, Virginia, take the door off, go in, and then when you get through, you come back, you fill the building back up with nitrogen again to the same level it was when you got in there, and you're responsible for paying for the nitrogen. So fortunately, I never had anybody get in there.
Is the nitrogen for preservation? Does it help preserve?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, you get a little bit of rust when you have oxygen. With nitrogen, you don't. Mm-hmm. And also, it would kill any insects. The insects need oxygen.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's break there for a moment.
All right.
And I'll change. Recording on this one again.
All righty.
All right, when we left off, we were with Apollo 1 and the storage of the module.
Mm-hmm.
Here in the community, when Apollo 1 occurred, you know, when the fire occurred, did you see where a lot of people just thought that this might have meant the end of Project Apollo?
Some of the people did, but we were still working on the Saturn V rocket. at that time. And a lot of the work was going on that way. And of course, we did make a very, very smart decision to go ahead and update the Apollo spacecraft to where it was a much safer vehicle. And they put a lot of that out in the press so people would know what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
So I felt, personally, I felt pretty good about it, that we were moving in the correct direction. Because, let's face it, the president had said that's what he wanted done. And even after Nixon had taken over as president, he knew what the thinking of the whole United States was. That was what we needed to do, was to be able to land somebody on the moon.
And so we're still progressing, and at this moment, and we haven't hit Apollo 8 yet, so we're not quite in December of 68. Are you personally concerned about the Soviet lunar effort?
Not too much. We were so busy with what we were trying to do, we didn't even get much information on what the Soviets were doing.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure there were people up in Washington and other places who were much more concerned than we were. We were just so busy down here trying to get done what we needed done. Now, you say you want to talk about Apollo 8.
Mm-hmm.
That was going to be the first manned flight to the moon. And one of the things that we had used for kind of a safety device was the lunar excursion module. And we didn't have a lunar excursion module ready, so we had to fly all the way to the moon and back with no lunar excursion module in there. And I thought that was a rather major decision, because the engine on the back of the Apollo spacecraft had to be fired 4 or 5 times, and there was no backup if it didn't work. So I thought that was one remarkable mission we flew. You didn't have any backup engine like the lunar module engine or anything else. You had one engine and that was it.
For you personally, Apollo 8 versus Apollo 11, which do you feel is the most significant flight?
Probably 8, because it was the first trip to the moon. That was the first time any Earth person had been beyond Earth orbit. And you had to go, if you go 17,300 miles an hour, you can stay in Earth orbit. But if you wanted to go beyond Earth orbit to go to the moon, you got to go 25,000 miles an hour. And your speed does not stay constant. You get it up to that speed, shut the engine down, and if the spacecraft goes off, it slows down, slows down, slows down, until it gets where the gravitational effect of the moon is greater than the gravitational effect of the Earth, and the speed builds back up. But it's not a constant velocity. So I just felt like that was a very, and especially to get there and have one engine that had to run several times with no backup. I think we could have, on the Apollo 11, the first landing on the moon, the thinking on that was we probably got a 50% chance of having this work, that they might have to abort while they were trying to land. In fact, a lot of us thought that Apollo 12 was going to be the first one to land on the moon. And if you look at the data from Apollo 11, they were within 20 seconds of running out of fuel when they landed.
With Apollo 11 and the possibility, like you said, that, mm-hmm. that 12 is really going to be the one that lands, mm-hmm. Did you see a lot of concern that Apollo 11, if it failed, that was going to be the end of it, that there'd be no Apollo 12?
Yes, there was a lot of people worried that way, that if we did it, because it was so different from what we had been doing. But all of us that worked on it, looked at it, said, We feel like we can make it work. We feel like we have, if the thing won't work, we know how to abort and get back without killing the crew.
Mm-hmm. And so with the success of Apollo 11, we've obtained the goal that Kennedy had set in 61.
Mm-hmm.
So now there begins a period of cutbacks. You know, the goal has been reached. We're going to start scaling down because we've got everything operational.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the only thing that we're going to do is we're going to, you know, make some changes to the command and service module. We're going to have the lunar rover. I mean, there's certain, you know.
Yeah, you added a lot to
you
it.
You add, but the basic structure is now in place.
Mm-hmm.
We're not creating as much as we did. So now we start to see some cutbacks, and with that, layoffs. You weren't, because you went right into shuttle.
Right.
Do you have recollection of people that you worked with who were laid off and the problems that they faced?
Yes, several of the contractor people. See, during the middle of the Apollo, which was really before we even made the first landing, we had like 25,000 people working on that program down here. And after Apollo got really going, and then after 72, when the last one landed, we were down to 8,000. So there was an awful lot of people. And a lot of them did not want to move out. They liked living in Florida, and they wanted to stay here. So a lot of people who were very, very good engineers and everything else, all they did was mow grass and that kind of stuff. I felt really bad about it. I was very, very fortunate because I was working on the shuttle.
Mm-hmm.
But I met a lot of people who were very, very talented people. That's all they were doing, was just trying to do something so they could stay here.
Did NASA have any cutbacks in relation to civil servants who weren't billeted yet?
Not too much. See, NASA never really had a whole lot of people. NASA, even when there was 25,000 people out there working on Apollo, only 2,500 were NASA.
Mm-hmm.
And we just kept hiring contractor people, but the NASA personnel didn't really change that much.
Mm-hmm.
It's gone down some now, but back in those days, it was not changed that much.
Okay. And in the community itself, did you see a lot of problems with storefronts closing up?
Yep, storefronts closing up. A lot of houses. You could buy a house. There's plenty of houses for sale that you could just go take over. You didn't even have to pay any money for it. You would have to pay money later on, you know, for the monthly payment.
Mm-hmm.
But there was a lot of stuff like that available.
And you're participating in shuttle early.
Mm-hmm.
And you said 1969?
Right.
Is when you move into shuttle. What is your first task?
My first task was, what was it we wanted KSC to do for the shuttle program? My first thing was to go to a meeting in Huntsville, Alabama, where all of the NASA centers got together, and we were trying to learn what they were talking about when they said space shuttle. And what we now have as a space shuttle is not anything too close to what we thought we really needed at that time. The vehicle that we were looking at, the cost to develop it would be about $10 billion, but the cost per flight would be 10 to 12 million. And we looked at whether we wanted to fly 40 or 60 times a year. And we started off on that, and then finally the congressional people came back and said, $10 billion is too much, $5 billion. So we started looking at that. And then they came down and said you can't spend $1 billion in any one year. And we ended up with what we've got is not very, it's kind of close to what we were talking about, but not real close. And right now, instead of the cost per flight being $10 to $12 million per flight, it's about $465 million per flight. And the maximum flights you can make per year is about 8 rather than 40 or 60.
So the entire concept of what the shuttle was going to be, yes, as a workhorse vehicle,
is different. Mm-hmm. We went for a long time debating about whether we were even going to build it or not. But since we decided we really needed to continue doing research in space, the shuttle is one way to do it. It's expensive to fly. And what we first started in was a two-stage vehicle that had hydrogen engines in both stages. And it took off, and the first stage would go to about somewhere around Mach 12 and let the orbiter go on up to orbit. And it would fly back to Kennedy Space Center and land. And you didn't throw away a lot of stuff, so you could do it again in 4 days. And it's not that way now.
Was there a lot of discussion about, and rather than going in the shuttle direction in 69, were there individuals who would have preferred to extend our stays on the lunar surface?
Not that I'm aware of. I'm sure that somebody would have. When we first started with what now is shuttle, we talked about a major program, and we wanted a 20-year-old program. We started in 1970, and by 1990, we knew what it would be. And what it amounted to was to have a space shuttle that could take people from Earth to Earth orbit. We had another space station that was going to be up there in Earth orbit. And we had one that was a little bit further out than that. And we had some nuclear-powered devices. You could strap those together, put three of them together, and fly on up to the moon and establish a lunar surface. And we had planned to have at least 200 people established on the moon. And by 1990, we had a six-man crew on the way to Mars. And it was going to cost money to do that. And as we started, what we first started was to have the shuttle and then the space station. And the space station was, that program was canceled before the end of 1970, and that we couldn't afford it. But that's really what the shuttle program started off as, something to just use to be able to get from Earth to Earth orbit so that you could go other places. And we really wanted to go up to, we thought the first manned different place other than the moon was to go to Mars. Now, how long it's going to take to do that, I don't know.
Okay, I'd like to just ask you one or two parting comments about the space program in general. For you, what is your personal, most memorable moment, personally?
I think right now, if you get into shuttle, say, probably the second shuttle flight, the fact that you could fly it twice. Every other thing I had flown before that, you never flew it but once. Mm-hmm. And before I came to work for NASA, I tested airplanes, and we always enjoyed making several flights on an airplane, and now we had this rocket thing that you could fly twice, and I was impressed with that.
So you had come full circle.
Yes.
And for the space program itself, of all the events that you were witness to, historically speaking, if you're going to leave a message for people in 300 or 400 years from now, mm-hmm, what you consider to be the most significant event of the space age that you were involved in, what is it?
Probably going to the moon, because that says you could get away from the Earth's environment and get other new environments that you had to worry about. But if you look at what it took to go to the moon and just make a drawing of what the Saturn V rocket looked like when it took off and then what you got back, you realize there was a lot of work to do. Because all you got back was a little bitty capsule that the three guys were. And when it took off, it was 363 feet long.
And when you say going to the moon, specifically Apollo 8 or more Apollo 11?
11, landing on the moon. Okay. We Apollo 8, we proved we could go to the moon. We had never flown anybody that fast before. But 11 was, we wanted to land on the moon and see how people could maneuver when the gravity is 1/6 of the Earth's gravity.
And is there any other parting thoughts that you might have, an interesting story, tales from an astronaut, a Cape worker, an amusing side story, anything like that that comes to mind?
Nothing comes to mind right now. Okay. I've about used it up, I think. But
okay.
I don't want to bore you.
No, you're not boring me at all. Not at all.
Oh. I've had a very good time doing it. You know, I graduated from college, and my degree is mechanical engineering, aeronautical options. And I had learned to fly when I was kind of in high school. And when I graduated, my daddy died between my freshman and sophomore year in college, so I had very little I had to do at home. And I went to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, Dayton, Ohio, and drove right over the flight test over there and told those people I wanted a job as an aeronautical engineer and I wanted a job flight testing, and they hired me. And they didn't ask me, was I an officer? And I had gotten a commission through the ROTC thing, but I hadn't been called to active duty, so the Air Force hired me as a civilian to help them flight test their airplanes. That lasted about 3 months. And then the colonel that was in charge of flight tests called me to come over and talk to him. And went over there, and he said, now Lieutenant so-and-so is doing this, Captain so-and-so is doing that. And I kind of figured what his problem was, so I told him, I said, well, I'm an officer, I'm just not on active duty. He said, you are now. So we talked for a while, and he says, okay, one thing we need to treat this correctly. He says, you're a pretty reasonable guy. He says, you come back to work here in 3 days with a uniform on. I didn't even change desks or get out of the airplane I was in or anything. So it's a good time. I did that for 3.5 years. And while I was up there, I logged time in 27 different kinds of airplanes.
Airplane-wise, you know, what was the most challenging aircraft that you ever flew?
The most challenging? Probably the F-104, because it burned all the fuel up in a big hurry. But the one that I enjoyed the most, I think, was an F-101. I could get, you could go 1.7 times the speed of sound, and I took that up to 65,000 feet when they told me it wouldn't go above 52,000 without changing the airplane. Mm-hmm. So I enjoyed that. But I had a lot of fun, and most of what we were testing were test airplanes, and they would take the original airplane and modify it to do something else. Like one of the airplanes I tested was the XB-52, which was the first B-52, but it was very, very old when I got it. And a B-52 normally has 8 J-57 engines in it. Well, they had taken the 4 outboard J-57s off and replaced them with 2 J-75s with afterburners. That's what we were testing, was the J-75 engine, not necessarily the B-52. And our job was to go fly that thing at 55,000 feet, see how those engines. But where I was not a test pilot. I was the flight test engineer. If you were a test pilot, you could fly fighter planes, or bombers, or cargo. You didn't get to fly all three of them. In flight test engineering, it didn't make any difference. So I had a good time.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, I'd like to thank you for participating.
Yeah.
And I enjoyed it. Enjoyed it very much.
I didn't bore you.
No, not at all.